live. Oh my goodness. We are up in here. I thought we had a few technical difficulties or something. Yay! Beauty and the Bee. I am your host, Mystery Styles, up at Beauty and the Bee, and I have my got a guest co-host today with me.
Melvin Jackson Jr.
Okay.
In MJJ. The building.
MJJ.
MJJ, baby.
Hey, the comedian extraordinaire, the funny man. Do you know producer, comedian, writer.
I try.
You just a jack of all trades.
Well, I try to be, but you know what? I'm going to be a master of something.
You're going
to
be a master of something?
Okay. And that's producing. That's producing products.
Positive products, meaning
whether it be uplifting somebody or making them into something more than what they are,
mm-hmm.
or producing great results.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't always have to be entertainment. It can just be producing great results.
Producing great results.
There you go.
I like that. Well, talking about great results, we have a call-in, and they are on the line right now. We're going to go over some back and forth about what went on this week, because we're back from an Easter Sunday weekend.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot of birthdays and stuff going
yes.
on, but I do not like to keep my guests holding. So we're going to talk to two of the founders of Frank Body Cosmetics. It's a wonderful cosmetics line. It's what's soft, smooth, and supple all over.
Mm. That just sounds like something.
It sounds like something, right? And it's, guess what? It's you after you use what's in this box. So let's be frank as I introduce Erica Garrett and Bree Johnson. And I hope I pronounced that right, because I know you guys are from Australia, so it might be a little twist to it. How are you?
Good, thanks. We've actually just got Bree. Ellie's unfortunately stuck on a plane still.
Oh, she's stuck on a plane? You guys are world travelers. How long does it take to get from Australia to Los Angeles?
Oh, it's 20 hours.
20 hours. Well, how are you
doing,
Bree?
We do it a lot, but it's good. We love it.
Okay.
Hold on. This is how you have to greet her. Aussie, Aussie, Aussie.
Oi, oi, oi.
I didn't know that. So what does that mean when we say Aussie, Aussie, Aussie?
Oh, it's just a chant that we do at all the sports, at sports events.
Yes.
Well, and then what's the response?
Oi, oi, oi.
Oi, oi, oi.
Oi, oi, oi. You know what? I'm still late. I just remember a commercial or something where it was someone, he said, are we going to put some shrimp on the bobby? Remember that? Okay, so
I have
to take a trip down under to come and see your
you
home.
You have to.
I'm going to have to. Well, welcome.
Have you not been before?
I've never been before. No, I have never been to Australia.
Gotta come. It's a long way away, but it's worth the plane.
It's so worth it. We'll be there. So I want to get into and talk about this wonderful product you have. You have some wonderful caffeinated products. We have lip scrub. We have body scrub. We have cocoa scrub. Mm-hmm. And the base of your products is coffee, right?
Exactly.
Okay. Yeah. So I know it's five of you guys in a startup, and you guys are all under 30, and that's just amazing to me. How did you come up with this concept or this company, for the company?
Oh, thank you. Well, yeah, we wanted to work on a product for a while. We've all been friends for a really long time, and we worked in a service-based industry, and so we were looking for a product that was in that health and wellness space. So my partner and co-founder, Steve, actually owns a bunch of cafes in Melbourne.
Okay.
Yeah, and so he had these ladies come into the shop, and they asked him for the old coffee grinds from the machine.
Okay.
And when he asked them what they wanted it for, they told him they use it as a body exfoliator.
Oh, wow. So kind of like how you do a sugar scrub.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
We did some research online, and it's one of those old wives' tales. People have been using coffee in skincare for a really long time, but no one was marking it up and producing it and manufacturing it in a professional way. And so we just started playing around with the recipes, literally making them at home in the kitchen. And yeah, we loved the scrub so much that we decided to take it to market. And so we launched 3 years ago with just the Humble Coffee Scrub.
Mm-hmm.
And now we have 10 SKUs, we sold to over 149 countries, and we've gone from a team of five to a team of over 20. So it's been a whirlwind, but it's been amazing.
So you said you have 10, I missed the word that was after that. You have 10
SKUs. Oh, 10 SKUs, so 10 different products.
Okay, 10 different products. Okay.
So are they like, you guys like the Starbucks of makeup?
Okay, that's awesome. So what products do you have now? Because I want our audience to kind of see, because you know, we're visual here, and I've already used it. We have, this is awesome. What I like about this is your body cream that I'm showing, and it's thick, it's rich. It's like, why don't you try some? I'm going to have Melvin try some. Look at that. It doesn't overpower you with the smell. It's rich. It's thick.
Oh, I might have to take some of this home with me.
You just rub it on. I mean, like, everything about it, it doesn't overpower the smell. And then you have the cocoa. Am I saying this right? Cocoa? Is that how you say it?
Yeah. Oh, the cacao. It's a cacao scrub. So the purple one.
Okay, cacao scrub. And then, and then we have, these are the lip scrub. Now this... our team, they're like, they want to eat it, but we know it's not.
Oh, wow.
It doesn't taste nice doing it. Right?
It does not taste. It's for the lips. It is not. These are not edible products, correct?
No, you can't eat them. They smell good enough to eat, but yeah, no, you can't eat them.
Okay, so what is it? How did you and your teammates meet with you, the Willow and Blake? You guys started that first before the Frank Body, correct?
Yeah, so me, Ari, and Jess have a content agency called Willow & Blake. So we're copywriters by trade. We specialize in tone of voice development, social media strategy, anything to do with words. So through that, that's how we decided to use social media to market Frank particularly.
And I think that it resonates with the, I guess when we see the visuals with your brand, everything is like really cute. And the wording is cute. Your press releases are cute. It's nothing that is normal. Your packaging is cute. Like, you open it, you feel like you're getting a gift. So how are they sold? Is it online only? Is this an online?
Yeah.
It's online only.
So currently we're all e-commerce, so all e-line. Like, the only place you can buy it is at frankbody.com. For us, we really want to connect with our customers on a personal level. We just felt in the natural beauty space, there was a lot of fluff and people were being a little bit boring. So yeah, we really wanted Frank to be a bit cheeky, a little bit more fun. And we just think natural skincare, it doesn't have to be boring. You can be fun and you can be sexy with it.
You can.
So this is for male and female, correct?
Yeah.
Good.
I don't see any males in your ads, but I mean, I'm thinking if you get in the scrub together, it's like get naked, get dirty, get rough, get clean. So anybody can get naked, get rough, get dirty.
Yeah, real men scrub. Females are predominantly our audience, but we do have a lot of couples that scrub. So a lot of the girls get their boys in the shower with them for a dirty scrub, which is a lot of fun.
Did you say the daddy scrub?
Yeah.
I love it. So what is it? What are your Frankfurts? Because I know your fans, a lot of people have names for their followers and their fans. What are your Frankfurts?
Yeah, so our Frankfurts are all of our customers. So if you look up hashtag the Frank Effect, you'll see over 100,000 images. That's all of our customers who've bought the product and loved it so much. They've taken a photo and uploaded it to their social media. And they're really the real reason, the heroes behind the brand. They're our biggest brand advocates and I guess like our loyal army that's really helped us grow so quickly and spread the word.
You have a new one here because I definitely love it. I was on your I was on your Instagram feed and I saw, I think her something baddie.
Baddie Winkle.
Oh my gosh, she's so awesome.
I know, she's amazing. We love her.
She is so awesome. So I know you guys don't like to really talk about numbers, but I'm talking about within 18 months, we're talking about 10 figures, over $20 million. How would you say you really launched yourself into the business to be this big so fast?
As I was saying before, it's really down to our customers. They've been our biggest brand advocates. We've had a lot of bloggers and models and Instagram celebrities post about the product, but it's really our customers that have helped us grow so quickly. So each of these girls, they might only have 100 or so followers, but when you've got 100,000 of them posting, it really adds up really quickly. So now we're kind of going in the opposite direction where we've started with social media and non-traditional advertising, and now we're really looking at more of an offline presence and more traditional advertising.
Are looking into getting into stores and in addition to your e-commerce, seeing yourselves on the products?
Yeah, we would love to have our own store eventually. We've got so many ideas for how a retail concept could work. So it's really just working out how we take that brand experience that we've created through our website and creating that in the real world.
So what are the benefits of having caffeinated skin products?
So many. So there's three key benefits. So the first is that coffee has the same pH as your skin, so it won't dry it out or damage it. The second is that caffeine can stimulate blood flow, which increases collagen production. It's also really great for targeting things like eczema, psoriasis, cellulite, stretch marks. And thirdly, coffee is full of antioxidants, and antioxidants are the things that target free radicals, and free radicals are what cause a whole range of skin conditions like acne and pimples and psoriasis and those kind of things.
So was it something that you like consciously thought about when the coffee beans came about, that you were like, this is going to be a healing process, or is something that kind of came about as you created your product line?
Yeah, I guess we never wanted to be a brand that, you know, made exaggerated claims or couldn't deliver on what it promises. But from our research, we knew that coffee was known to have all these amazing benefits. About 3 months after, 6 months after we launched, we started having all these customers writing into us with these feedbacks and these before and after photos. So we created another separate account called Frank Feedback, which is where we basically show the results that our customers have had. So following that, we engaged a medical researcher to do a lot more research into the benefits of coffee so we could understand why they work the way they do. And after that, we decided that every single one of our products had to have coffee in it.
Have to have coffee. So what's next for Frank Body when you're expanding your line? I mean, I've showed the lip scrub, this amazing body cream, lip balm, and scrubs. But what's next?
We've got a few more products coming out this year. We've got travel packs on the way. So a lot of our Frankfurts, ourselves included, we love to take scrub away with us when we're traveling. So our travel packs are four original scrubs. They're just mini versions of them, and they come in a really cute little envelope that you can take overseas with you. After that, we've got some face masks coming out, and then everything else is kind of top secret.
Wow. You mean you're holding back? Brie.
I know. Yeah, but a lot more products for the face and the body.
Face and the body. So we have some
skin. All natural.
All natural caffeinated blends of Frank Body. So we're all Frankfurts here. Just know.
Yeah, amazing.
Thank you. And congratulations, too, that you guys were voted for your Willow & Blake company, specifically one of the top 10 female companies under 40, but you guys are all actually under 30, and I think that's amazing.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I feel like I'm older than I am.
Wow. Well, I mean, congratulations. Congratulations on your expansion. And we look forward to having, I guess, more of your products.
Oh, thanks so much. Yeah, we'll have to send you some.
Yes, and so for our consumers too, because we've been putting it on Instagram and everybody's been like, I want to try. How do you get it? Go to frankbody.com, follow you on, can you give us your social media?
Yeah, of course. So frank_bod on Instagram and frankfeedback on Instagram.
Feedback, just to be specific, is for your befores and afters, correct?
Exactly. And the frank_bod is our main channel.
So let's be frank and all get the frank effect, correct?
Exactly.
Thank you, Brie. I really appreciate
it. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me.
Okay. And thank you for putting so much love into your product so we could have all this caffeinated stuff without coffee.
Amazing.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Take care.
Bye.
Well, that was awesome. Did you guys like the product?
Yeah, let me go. I haven't. Yeah, I like this one, definitely.
You like that? Did you smell it?
Oh, I smell it. Yeah, it smells good. I'm going to take some of this for myself.
All of us do. We want it.
We need to share. We should. I get it on Monday and Tuesday.
She said you could do the daddy scrub. I just love accents, period. Yeah. Because, I mean, I could understand everything, but it's just like, you know, and then they're like, hey, babe, and all that. They have, like, so much. But I just really think the success of this company is amazing. Like, literally, they are not even 2 years old.
That's crazy.
And they're over 20 million. They're in Australia, United States, United Kingdom, and they're coming Canada, and then soon to like Dubai and Russia. And
we might need to get in the business. We might need to do something because that's serious. But social media is definitely, you know, helping a lot of businesses get to the next level. You know?
I think what's key, and what I was listening to and just reading up on their company, is that there's five founders. She's one of them. That was Brie that we spoke to. But there's five founders, and they all uniquely bring something different. And I think that although that's like, it's like one of those aha moments and you're like, duh, like everybody has to bring something different. But I mean, when you think about how they put the pieces to the puzzle, she made it sound simple, but it really, I mean, it really isn't simple. It really, I mean, I guess it was simply put together because you have an idea, you run with it and you go with it. But they all had different skills. Like they started with like, let me get your coffee grounds. Let me see what this does. Oh, let's do a thing. And because because they had the communications experience with their branding, right. They put that together with social media, put some really nice packaging together, and it's like, voila, it's almost 2 years later, they're in 149 countries.
See, women, y'all running the world, man. See, guys better stop playing.
Y'all, you need us.
I know. Yeah.
It's a duality.
I wouldn't be here with a wonderful woman, so why?
Right.
There you go.
You know what? You're married, right?
Yes.
Okay, so don't be giving me no Google eyes.
Hey, listen, I'm not.
Okay,
it's just my eyes.
It's just your eyes? Okay. But I know, I just read that she was an actress as well. How is it to be two thespians in the house?
It's great because I think there's a time, like I had to learn this relationship, there's a time where it's like I need to just be there to support her and be husband and not the actor Melvin.
Okay.
And, you know, those moments where she's just there to support me and vice versa. And I think that plays a great part of being a team because it can't be all, you can't always be on.
Right.
And sometimes you got to be the supporting one when they need you. I need you to be my husband. I'm like, okay, I need you to be my wife.
Mm-hmm.
And it just works. You know how to, it's no competition. And
it's no competition.
It's fun.
So we're going to get into, before we get into everything that you have going on or been having going on, I want to say some happy birthdays. It's MC Hammer's birthday today.
Hammer, happy birthday.
I was just saying that. I said Hammer been around a long time. Remember, who had some parachute pants?
I had those.
You had those? Yeah. Did you do that?
I had the track, too. I had the little tracks and everything.
Which? Oh, and
the
hair.
Yeah.
Oh, remember when they used to do them in their eyebrows?
Yeah.
You do?
I think I might have did it one time.
You might have hit that one.
I was close. Call almost cut the eyebrow off. Like, whoa. It's close.
Yeah, that was. I remember they used to have them in the sideburns. Yeah.
Him and Vanilla Ice.
Wait, speaking of Vanilla Ice, they're doing an I Love the 90s throwback concert on tour. They're touring. I think they're going to be in like 10
cities. Him and Hammer?
Hammer, Vanilla Ice, Salt and Pepper.
Oh, that's a sign.
I want to say it's like 7 acts. Like, I got to look it up. I don't want to quote anything because it's not in front of me. But, I mean, I just saw the ad and I was like, what? It's called I Love the 90s Tour.
See that.
I would go see that, too. Celine Dion's birthday.
Okay.
Friend of the show, Sunday Carter, is having a birthday.
Okay, that's my friend, Sunday.
Sunday.
Yeah, we did a movie together. That's my girl.
Her publicist, Shauna. Okay. Shauna, I'm
sorry.
I got
to do something.
Aries.
Is it April? When is it? April?
I think they're all today.
I'm April 4th, so...
You're Aries,
yeah,
too?
I'm Aries all day.
My birthday.
Yeah, what, are you Aries?
No, I just have a lot
I was about to say.
Aries were the favorite.
Oh, really? With two Libras up in here? With three Libras up in here, you're going to tell us that Aries are your favorite?
No, they were.
Oh, they were.
They still are. Listen. Hey, we champions all day. I can't speak for everybody, but I'm speaking for myself.
You speak for yourself? Okay. Well, yeah, it's a lot of Aries. My mom is an Aries. It's a lot of Aries. Yeah,
I like your mom already.
You like her already? Yeah, okay.
She did good.
She did. Of course she did. No, I'm just kidding. Eric Clapton.
Okay.
And Eric Clapton, he's a rock and roller Hall of Famer. And just a small fact about the Hall of Fame, there's 21 musicians that have been inducted twice, including the late, great Curtis Mayfield in 1991 and 1999. Music royalty Michael Jackson was inducted in 1997 and again with the Jackson 5 in 2001. So, and I mean, as a solo artist again, right? So that's three times for him. So that's a super big deal. But speaking of the Hall of Fame, when I read this and saw this, you know, next month, NWA is being inducted into the Hall of Fame, right? April 8th or something.
That's good.
And guess who's presenting it? Kendrick Lamar. Like, wow. How iconic is that? Yeah. So when I thought about that, I thought about you because I was like, we just saw NWA the movie, and it's been all this chitter chatter about there being a sequel, and you might be a part of that. What's up with that? You got any news for us?
Well, it's not really a sequel.
It's not really a sequel.
It's called DPG for Life, which is like Dog Pound for Life, talking about Daz, Corrupt, and Snoop and their journey.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of continuation of NWA's Straight Outta Compton.
Oh, yeah. So, see, look, we got some pictures. So, that's Curtis Young, Dr. Dre's son. That's you in the middle.
Yes.
Looking like Daz right there. Exact and who's that to the right of you?
That's Daz's son to the right, and then I'm playing Corrupt.
Oh, you're playing Corrupt. Yeah. I'm sorry. That's Daz's son?
Yeah.
Hey, that big?
Right. Yeah. And he played Daz in the Tupac movie. He just came back from doing the Tupac movie in Atlanta.
He just played Daz's son in Atlanta for what?
He played his father, Daz, in the Tupac movie.
Oh,
yeah. So he's playing Daz in the
Yeah, that one's coming out, later this year?
Like September, I believe.
Okay, yeah, I'm waiting on that. I can't wait. They haven't been doing a lot of, I guess because it's not time to do the publicity for it. But
he's been on Instagram, Facebook.
So yeah.
It looks
all over Facebook.
Yeah, I know, LT, because, well, you know what? It's been a lot of transitions with that film, yeah. I'm going to be honest. They went from, I was, like, super, like, excited when I saw that John Singleton was directing it. Not saying that I'm not excited for the new director. I know he's very experienced and has done some work, and I mean, you know, they changed because of a certain reason. There's probably a reason for it.
Yeah, of course.
But then it lost a little bit of the momentum of me hearing about it. But I know LT being a part of it. I want to say he said he had something to do. Did he have something to do with the NBA? At least musically, maybe? With the NBA film?
I'm not sure. He might have.
He might have. You know, everybody's connected. Six degrees of separation.
And you know Deshaun Jackson is one of the producers of the Tupac movie. A lot of people didn't know that.
Okay. So, what do you think? I didn't mean to interrupt your story. It's just like all that. It was like all these 6 degrees. It was like three things going on, right? So, what are we doing? What's going on with that?
I know the script is done. They're still just tweaking on some things, getting it right.
Okay.
I believe we got some people coming over to help out. Mm-hmm. But I think the main thing is just making sure we take our time with it, don't rush it, because it is a situation that's like has to be done right.
So, is Snoop Dogg's son gonna play Snoop Dogg?
Nah, I don't think so. It would be good, but I don't think so.
You don't think so?
But it's definitely going to be a great situation. Mm-hmm. Like just the way we gelled when we first got together and shot a promo.
Mm-hmm.
Dre's son looks like him. And Tupac, who's played by Day Day. It's just Dre's a great group of people. And I think that once we get everything together, it's going to become a beautiful story.
Okay, that's going to be awesome. Well, I think that it's good that we're seeing the stories retold that a lot of people aren't familiar with, but they've heard so much about. Like, these are iconic music in hip hop.
Exactly.
And, I just think it's a great story to be told. Yeah. I can't wait to see it. I'm excited for you.
Yeah, it's just everything's about to happen. They got the new edition movie about to be done.
There's a lot of stuff behind that too, because I think New Edition wanted to say they didn't really want to support it because it's not on TV. How do you feel about that?
It's gonna be on TV.
It's not gonna be in.
That was Bobby Brown.
Bobby Brown was the only one saying he didn't support.
From what I heard.
So what do you feel about it being made for TV versus film?
Because
theater.
I think that. It's good, man. I think when you make it for TV, it's right there at the people's, you know, they can just get it if they want it.
Mm-hmm.
Where sometimes it's a movie, it takes a long time to get to the movies.
Mm-hmm.
And it could do well in the movies, and you don't know. You just, it's one of those things you don't want. Sometimes you don't want to gamble. So a lot of people may not know about New Edition like they know about NWA.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little different, you know, situation. But I'm a New Edition fan all day, so, you know, I'm going to go see it whether it's in the movie, on TV.
Mm-hmm.
Or whatever, but you just don't want it done right.
Their story is interesting. I mean, they toured. They're still touring, aren't they?
Yeah, they're touring right now.
And so is the dancing.
And every concert I went to is they turn it out. It's like since a kid to now, like I've seen them. Like I'm still a fan. It's amazing.
Okay, that's awesome. So a lot of people know you from Everybody Hates Chris. How was that experience? What was one of your first acting gigs? But I mean, I'm very familiar with that role. But what was one of your first acting experiences, and how was it getting on such a successful show starting your career?
My first acting gig was a PSA that I auditioned for. It was my first time acting, and I went in there and I booked a role, and I was like, this is what I wanted to do, and then it led on to like auditioning for The Wire, 15 times. Before getting on, and then being also an extra on the first one, season one and two, before I got on as a recurring role, so it was definitely a journey, and made me realize how much work it takes to be an actor, and it's a
staying persistent,
right?
Because 15 times, a lot of people would be.
I was done. I was like, I ain't going back.
A lot of people would be like that, but you're like, I'm gonna go back.
Right.
They told me to come back.
Come on, show. What's my favorite show? So they call you, you gonna go. Even though you're like, man, I'm tired, but that's how it is sometimes. You're going to be tired. But it may be that last time when you give a deal that go, that it'll be like, okay, this is your opportunity. And you go in there and you come out as a winner.
Right. So where was that shot?
Baltimore,
B-more.
Yeah.
So it's true, because, I mean, it was set in B-more, so it had to be shot in B-more.
Right.
And where are you originally from?
D.C.
So it's kind of you. That's all in your territory.
Right there, DMV.
DMV. So, okay, what was next after that? What was next after that?
When I did The Wire, then I came out to L.A., got my feet wet.
Okay.
I gave myself a month to be here, and I said, if I don't, you know, book anything in a month, I'm going to go back home.
That's a short amount of time. That's a real...
Listen, I had at the time I was married before. I had the kids, so I didn't want to... come out here and not get things done because I had my family back home.
Right, okay.
So I gave myself that time period. That was an agreement between me and my ex-wife. It's like, you know,
okay.
Gave myself that month. Mm-hmm. Within 3 weeks, I got an agent. And then the same day I was about to meet the agent, she gave me an audition for Everybody Hates Chris.
Okay.
And that's the day I booked it. Then I went in for one role, but didn't get that role, but they liked me, so they gave me they cast me as a different role.
Okay.
And I became a recurring role on the show.
And then that was the story behind Everybody.
Yeah.
Do you guys all still keep in touch?
Yeah, every now and then I'll see Tashina and Terry Crews, see them all the time, so it's love. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you would think that since my part wasn't as big, like, they would be like, oh, but it's like, it's love.
It's love.
It's love, and you just keep, you know, they'd be like, hey, we was on the show with me, and it's a beautiful situation. And to work with Chris Rock, like, it was amazing for him to.
His voice is so funny. I think that's a good thing. What do you find about, how do you prepare for comedy versus film? Because I know it has to be a difference.
Comedy, I think it's being natural. Mm-hmm. Some people, I don't believe that you can try to be funny. You either are funny or you're not. Mm-hmm. Like, of course, if you have funny things written for you, but it's all about delivery.
Mm-hmm.
And I think when it becomes a natural gift and natural, when you just boom, 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 it happens in comedy. And that's the thing about comedy. Mm-hmm. You can have something on the script, but sometimes things that come out, and you're like, oh, man, we'll keep that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the beautiful thing about comedy.
I think because I hear in your voice, like, you know, I could hear that you do impressions, don't you? No, because I could hear it. It's like I hear different characters already. And I think when you said that, right. it spoke to me in that way. Do an impression for us. Do something.
Hey, yo, it's DMX. Rough Riders. Hey, my man's in them. You know, we on that ride. You know, my man's in them. And then I was working on Cat Williams. I don't know if I can.
Woo!
Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Cat Williams, and I am not a boy, Damon. I am not a boy, Damon.
What do you think about Cat Williams? I know you're not, I mean, not from a judgmental sense, like, what do you think about him just being in the news every week with something different?
It's sad because he is a talented guy.
Yeah.
And he's very, you know, knowledgeable.
Uh-huh.
I think it's just maybe he's lost.
Mm-hmm.
And I think instead of us criticizing, I think we should pray for him.
Yes.
Because you never know in the situation you may be in. You don't know what he's going through, whatever it is, but he just needs people around him that's like, Cat, sit down. Like let's come over here and they need to have his back.
Right.
And not just letting him get into all this craziness, because we're going to wake up tomorrow and he's going to be dead or something worse. So, it mean, we just need to really pray for him, and people around him need to really just be there for him and not let him keep getting himself in this situation.
Right. I mean,
especially
just,
when he has kids, too, you know.
He does. He has a kid. He has a family. I know. It was said that rumored. I mean, I don't know who's dating who. I don't try to keep up with everything. But I just know one of the reality personalities, Hazel E., they were supposed to be an item or what have you. And then they called her. I think TMZ called her in the airport one day. She was like, don't ask me. I don't. Like, you know what I mean? It's like everybody's kind of stepping away.
Right.
And so
That's how it is. You know what I mean? People with you when you up, when you down, everybody disappears.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not real friends.
Mm-hmm.
Those are fair weather friends. And so you just got to make sure you have the right people around you that's going to be there with you when you down, when you up, when you down again.
Your teammates.
Teammates, yeah.
I got
family.
Family. Family is very important. Is he from the East Coast as well? I don't even know where he's
from. From Cincinnati, Ohio.
Oh, yeah. I should know that. You know, I should really, really know that. So what, I read something. You were an athlete. Did you live in, like, Pakistan?
Yeah, I lived in Pakistan.
Explain, give us a little bit about, how did that come about?
Well, my mother, she worked for the government.
Okay.
So when I was about 8 years old, went overseas to Pakistan, lived there for about 4.5 years.
What was that experience like?
It was great.
It
changed my mind as a kid and allowed me to see things from a different point of view and not just, you know, on the American side of it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they over there, going to America is success for them. They're like, oh, I got to go to America.
Mm-hmm.
And here we are in America and complaining about things. It's like they're over there in poverty, like for real, like washing up with the same water they have to drink.
Oh.
They have to wash their clothes in. And we think that we're going through something, but they want something totally different.
So when you say they're doing that, if you're there, what are you drinking?
Well, we drinking purified water. Like,
okay.
You know, we have a situation to where we're in a whole nother location.
Okay.
To where, you know, we're not.
But you're talking about certain areas.
Yeah, certain areas
that's
what's going on. Like, they're living in huts and tents and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't have the luxuries that we may have.
Mm-hmm.
So the whole situation is going on in Flint. that's going on. That's been going over there for years. So.
Wow. I mean, Flint, I mean, they had, I think Revolt did something maybe about a week ago about just rallying for Flint and their water system. But you really, it just doesn't seem normal when you're talking about United States that a city can go on that long and they knew about it and not doing
politics.
It.
I mean, and that's the thing. It's crazy about politics. When things get involved, people's lives are at stake. You think about how can you not care about another person's life?
Mm-hmm.
If it's about dollars will always, you know, oversee this person's life, and it's crazy.
It shouldn't, though. I mean, humanity is something. I think that's why I love philanthropy so much and, like are drawn to people that do good in that way, because it's just like, how could you not have a sense of humanity when you see someone struggling like that? Because that could be our next future leader. It could be in a different country, but that could be our next future leader that could change the world. I mean, the way the computers are, I watch like nieces or our cousins and stuff, and they're like 1 and 2, and they like know the code to your phone and can get. I'm like, wait a minute, are you a genius or something?
Yeah.
I remember like being in elementary. Like I think I've always had a computer. I'm not gonna say, but I don't always remember doing reports and stuff and having Google at my direct access.
Nah.
I remember having to go to a library
exactly.
in school. I remember things like that. But I mean, gone are those days. It's not that they're not still available or you can't still do the research, but I mean, everything is so accessible online. So it's so instantaneous.
Right. And think about this, right? How often do you have to know a word? You text and it'll autocorrect it for
don't.
You. You like, and then you when you don't have it, you don't even know how to spell the word anymore because you're so used to using the autocorrect.
Or it'll replace it with the word of their choice for you. I've looked up on my phone. I was like, that is not what I was trying to say or wanted to say, but it did it anyway. So, how old are your children?
My oldest is 17. I have a middle that's 12 and 8.
Oh, okay. So they need you right there.
Yeah.
You right there. Yeah. Are they catching the acting bug as well?
Well, yeah, all my kids have been in projects with me.
Okay.
My oldest child, he's been in several projects with me, and, he's doing acting as well.
Mm-hmm.
He has natural gift for it.
Mm-hmm.
But I definitely want them to be owners of something and not just be... let's say employees. I want them to be able to have their own legacy to leave with their kids and build something. So that's what I want to teach them, how to be a businessman first before anything else.
Businessmen first. I think you've done an excellent job at that. I mean, to set a goal, to come out here and say, okay, I have 30 days, and then really meet that goal, that's showing your kids something right then and there. So how is it that as an actor, I know your credits. I mean, we could pull it up on IMDb, but I want you to tell our audience. You've also written, directed. I mean, you've written for some hit shows and films. So how did all that come about? Like, was it just in you?
No, you know what's crazy? Mm-hmm. I didn't really... Writing wasn't a thing that I wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
I think the first thing I wrote was kind of like my life story in the sense of me raising my kid at being 17, raising a kid on my own, and just that whole situation of being in high school. And then the first script
that hard being a father in high school?
Absolutely. Because I had to change everything. I was going away to school, and when I found out I was having a kid, I had to change everything. I went to a community college because I was like, I wanted to be there for my kid.
Mm-hmm.
And then at 9 months, I became a full-time dad, you know, when I got custody of him. And it just was a blessing in disguise in a sense to where it made me more of a man than I thought I could be at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And it just challenged me to go even further than where I was.
And maybe set goals earlier than maybe you would have set them before.
Yeah. And I have the help of my parents. That was a great thing. I didn't have to do it alone.
Okay.
So sometimes we like, oh, you got a kid at 17. And the parents just kind of like look down on you a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, they just like, okay, you did this. Now let's see how we're going to move forward. And they supported me. But I still had to do my part in making sure that I was held responsible for what I created, and make sure that I was a great father.
Excellent. So that was how. Okay, I think I asked 2 questions.
So let me get back to the script.
Right,
so the script. So so I was doing a video with Yayo's video. He's when he first
the
got
rapper?
Out. Yeah.
Okay.
And we was on his tour bus, and I had my script with him, and I gave it
how
to.
How did you guys meet? You just pulled him out of well, I guess the East Coast thing.
Well, I found out they were doing a video,
okay.
And so I had some people I knew reach out to him, and they was like, "Yeah, have him come down to the video set." It was like, "I know you don't." No, I was not love you. I forgot the song,
mm-hmm.
but So then I gave him the script. Mm-hmm. And then the next thing I know, he was like, 50 wants you.
What?
50 was on the other bus. He was like, 51, talk to
50
you.
50 Cent?
So I go in the bus at 50 Olivia, mm-hmm. and he's holding my script in his hand. He was like, you wrote this? I'm like, yeah. He was like, well, I'm going to be doing some movies straight to DVD. You know, I'm looking for some stuff. And this was right around the time he was doing Get Rich or Die Trying.
Oh, wow.
So my
okay.
first script that I wrote, 50 Cent held it in his hand. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to write some more stuff.
Right, that's
so then the next time I wrote another script, and I gave it to 50 again because I had this something in mind that I wrote exactly, you know, for G-Unit and... it was like...
Like a treatment for a video or something?
Yeah. No, it was for a movie.
A film,
it's
okay.
It's called... I can see. The Game Done Changed. The Game Done Changed.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's going to be a bunch of actors from The Wire and then rappers.
It's coming out?
It may happen.
Okay.
So I don't know if they're going to be involved.
50 Cent is a great... Like, I admire his hustle behind the scenes when it comes to music. Because, I mean, a lot of people, when there's a beef involved with rap or whatever, and they want to write you off if... you have a single that just doesn't blow up or
right.
it doesn't sell or there's not as much success as your first album with your sophomore
yeah.
album or all of that. But I guess I got a little messy. I'm sorry. You know, I get a little messy. Spread it all out. You know, all this Frank Body Cod. We're going to have a promo just to cut. We're going to do a promo and give away some of these Frank Body products because I forgot to ask her what else about the Frankfurts. You know what I mean? Because all you guys that want to be Frankfurts, we have a contest coming up. But no, when you say with 50 Cent, it's just he has like so many like successes with film and
right.
TV with his relationship with, what's the TV channel that he just, The Power?
Power, yeah. That's
Stars.
On Stars, yeah.
So yeah, so I mean getting the script in his hands is
yeah.
like, golden.
Yeah, and it was just a blessing because, you know, you never take it, you know, and you never know what may come out of it. And I think that was just letting me know.
Oh, we have a caller. Somebody wants to talk to you. Melvin, sorry. You got to say something. No, I'm just kidding. Hi, caller. How are you? Thank you for calling Beauty and the Beat.
Hey, how are you?
I'm wonderful.
Hey, Melvin Jackson Jr.
Hey, how you doing?
Fine. How are you?
Great.
You're really cute.
Oh.
Thank you so much.
Are you married?
Yes, I'm married.
So why you don't know your wife's voice? I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. I'm kidding.
Hey, baby.
Oh, hi.
I just wanted to say that I'm so proud of you. You are an awesome man of God and a wonderful father and a wonderful husband. And I pray that all of your heart's desires would come to fruition, and I love you.
Thank you so much. I love you, too. Aww. See, this is how you support each other, y'all, man. This is love right here.
Yes. Yes. I love it, and we spoke on that earlier.
Yeah.
I asked him, what was it like being in a relationship where you both are actors and pursuing, you know, this business together? And he had the most positive answer. He said, we support each other as a team. Sometimes it's time to be a husband and sometimes it's time to be, you know, a supporter or things of that nature. And I thought that was beautiful.
That is. I missed that part. I'm sorry. I just started watching maybe like 20 minutes ago.
Okay, you caught him. You caught him. You got us.
Yeah, and kudos to you, a very, very great job, and continue doing what you're doing as well.
Thank you, I appreciate it.
Wow. Of course, of course.
Bring some of this product home, babe.
Yes, Frank Body. Frank
okay.
Body called in. You guys are going to have to be Frank where she says she's going to have to send you some so you can know how to do the daddy scrub.
Okay, then. Rub my daddy down. We's married now.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yes, we's married now. So you guys have children together, right?
No, we don't have.
You don't
children
have children together.
Not yet.
So y'all gonna work on
we
it. So daddy scrub might help you work on that.
Okay.
Okay. Nah, I'm serious. So what do you have that you're working on right now? You want to tell us about any of your projects? You guys worked together before?
Not yet.
Not yet? Okay, not yet.
We haven't, and I didn't want to hijack the interview. You know, I know that this was about my husband, so I just want to be supportive of him. Yeah, I mean, I work on a TV show called Grandfather with John Stamos.
Yes, that's
And that's excellent. Pretty much, yeah, that's what I have going on. We do have some things in the works that we're working on together, trying to produce and get out there. He had an amazing idea for something, and I just wanted to hop on board because I was like, this is something that I've never seen before. It's fresh, it's new, it's interesting. It's something for children, and it's something that I would definitely want my children to watch. That's kind of what we are working on together.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, that's excellent. Good luck, and congratulations on the Godfather.
Grandfather.
Grandfather. I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. Many people call it Godfather.
I mean, it's Grandfather. I want people to tune in and watch that and everything. But thank you for calling in and supporting your husband here.
Of course. He's amazing.
Thank you, baby.
For having him on.
I'll see you when I get home.
Hey. Okay, boo.
All right, boo.
Daddy Scrub.
Okay,
thank you.
All right. Bye.
Bye. Okay, so that's awesome. So there goes that teammate.
Yeah, teamwork.
Make the dream work. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, that's excellent. So you guys are kind of working on something together.
Yeah.
So you keep it in the family. You write. Did you even cast before?
I cast. Pretty much stuff that I write, I pretty much have in mind who I'm going to cast.
So you might be
a host on there. Yeah, I got you. You know what I mean? Listen. We look out for each other. It's all in the family.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I appreciate that. So what else can you tell us about? What's next?
What's next? I got two projects in the can.
Okay.
I co-directed and produced a short comedy film called Friend Zone.
Mm-hmm.
Women always put dudes in the friend zone when it should be the dude they with.
Right.
And so it's a take on that situation where a guy, he's really the guy for her, but she looks over him and say, oh, you're so sweet, you're so nice.
Mm-hmm.
And she instead goes with another guy. And it's like he's put in that friend zone category.
That happens a lot, I'm
That's
sure.
My life.
Yeah.
I literally do that to all the guys, and my other guy friends are like, are you retarded? And I'm like, I thought he was really nice.
See?
And then
that movie's for her.
That movie's for you.
And then we have another movie shot called The Passing, which is a horror film, mm-hmm. short horror film. African American horror film.
So are we dying?
So we run away. No, they live.
Some people die, some people live. But not all the black people die in this one. Let's just say that.
So I have a question with horror. Because I'm so extremely terrified of scary stuff. Like, to watch it, it's like I can't. Like, you know what I mean? So I'm like cooling chin. And, like, no. So when you're filming it and you're being as authentic as possible, do you ever get scared? Or is it...
What was crazy about this? This was the funnest... scary movie I've done, you know, mm-hmm. and since you don't think like to have fun doing a scary movie, but it was fun mm-hmm. because I did it with friends, and it was authentic, it was genuine, and I just think that we have fun doing it, and I think that people are gonna love what they see, and man, like my first horror film, like it was amazing. And
what's the name of it?
It's called The Passing.
The Passing.
It's The Passing, The Ghost of Dion.
The Ghost of Dion.
Yeah, there's so many other passings
so
out there.
So who is Dion?
Dion is the dude whose wife I'm messing with.
Cool.
Yeah, I know. It's dirty. It's just acting.
He gonna pass through on you. Like, you messing with my wife and I'm not here. You didn't have nothing to do with that passing though, did you?
Hey, can't tell you the whole movie now. It's a short film. If I tell you, look, I'll tell you everything. It'll be it. That'll know the movie.
Okay. So what is the process when you do a short film because I read something like NBC. I was reading something about
NBC Shorts. Yeah.
The Shorts, they do something. I thought that was excellent.
Yeah, doing a short, it pretty much will be able to open up doors for you to do a feature, possibly. Mm-hmm. I know NBC Shorts, they do shorts all the time where they'll allow you to do something and then you show it at this, if it makes
festival.
It in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's great opportunities for people. I've seen some shorts, I'm like, wow, this is a short?
Right.
It's just phenomenal of mm-hmm. what they're doing, so... Shorts are not shorts anymore like they used to be. Like, okay, you do a short.
It's a presentation.
But what are you doing?
Right.
But now you have opportunities for it to be shown on TV. Mm-hmm. I forgot, it was like KTLA did something recently where they show like four or five short films
mm-hmm.
on their channel.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just a door opener, I would say. And there's distribution for it now. Mm-hmm. So you got stuff on Netflix.
Netflix,
yeah.
Hulu,
yeah.
Apple TV is doing something
yeah.
with Dre.
Yeah.
You know, this is their first ever entry. The Apple TV is big. I mean, you know, you have all those it's about like 50. I don't want to name numbers, but they have programs on there. But this is their first time actually making an Apple TV network, I think. So the first project that they're doing is something with Dr. Dre.
As they should.
Why not? Then the next one will probably be with Drake. Yeah, the next one will probably be with Drake. You know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, I mean, I just think it's excellent that the distribution outlets and accessibility that films have now, it's kind of like to get your work out there.
And you know what was scary in the beginning was that I will say I want to do my own project, but it's like then you're always looking for funding. You're like, I don't have funding. But now there's so many opportunities for you to even, you know, people that have cameras, and you don't always have to go to a network. Or you have all these avenues like the internet. So now you can shoot something on your phone and put it out there. So there's no excuse why you can't create something. Like, I find myself watching less TV and creating more, because it's like, listen, I'm trying to
creating
get something
more.
On. Yeah, I'm trying to get something on TV.
Okay, gotcha.
And movies. Mm-hmm. And if I'm sitting there watching somebody else, then what am I doing?
I don't want to just
be a consumer anymore. I want to be a person that has the product that people want.
What do you think about reality TV as far as getting yourself out there as a brand to get recognition? Someone like yourself, really, who has a foundation in acting and just being out there in entertainment, may or may not need it. But sometimes people use it as a like something to boost their career. And I feel like I have an opinion, but what's your opinion on reality TV?
I say it does what it needs to do for people. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you see somebody like a K. Michelle who went through what she went through, and now she now has a following. She can sell records.
Right.
So she utilized that for her purpose.
She added a little dash of ratchetness, but she had to do what she had to do.
Sometimes you have to do what you have to do. It's not for everybody.
It's not. Okay.
Like, I just say, if I'm a part of a reality show, I can't be the opposite of who I am, because people are going to be like, that's not real. They know, people that know me, they're like, come on, this dude's just putting on a show. And I don't need that. If that's what I need to do to get on, then it ain't meant for me to be on.
Right.
So, but everybody has their own reason for what they have to do, and you can't be mad because they want to make money.
So you would do it if for the right reasons. You would do it.
I would do it if it made me look good.
Okay.
Not look bad, you know.
But I mean, I'm gonna tell you about reality TV, because I don't say tons of people I know, but I mean, I know a lot of reality TV personalities that really say if they had this to do over and over again, like they. It's something about like being out there. I think that you really have to be smart about it and know what your end result that you want from it, because you don't have a say so in how that it is. You're not going to be the final word most of the time.
And that's why you have to be the boss. That's why you have to be a boss and not just be.
Hey, I love
a person that's just, oh, let me be an employee. Nobody wants to always be an employee. I know, that's why you leave your 9-to-5, to not be an employee.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And even though as an actor, it's different, you know, you're still an employee, but when you are able to write the checks and also have a say-so of what goes on, that makes a difference.
Okay, that's true. So, we're going to, you know what, do we have time? Do you know, you mentioned that you did, you saw... What was this? Some films coming out that we wanted
Barbershop,
to...
Barbershop.
Yeah. So I wanted to talk, like, it's three films this week. Meet the Blacks is coming out. Okay. That's Mike Epps, right? He's coming out. A Weekend with the Family is this weekend, right? Okay.
Today, right?
That Friday,
April
not today.
Today.
Okay, April 1st. Okay, so the premiere is today. April 1st it comes out. And then you saw Barbershop that comes out in 2 weeks. Yeah. How was that?
That was great. I think it was the best one.
The way the picture, I was like, is he in it? And then your friend,
right?
I was like, somebody said, hey, you did good in that. I was like, was he in it? I had to look. I was like,
I'm not in it, but thank you. She's like, you got a lookalike in there. I was like, nah, it wasn't me.
It wasn't you?
I didn't cash a check from it. So.
Okay, they better not put this. Are you using my likeness?
Right.
But what did you think of the film?
It was great.
That was Nicki Minaj's, like, I won't say her first, but it was like kind of that film.
I mean, and it was a great film. I think everybody did a great job, and I laughed from beginning to end. And it had great messages in it, and when it talked about, you know, the killings in Chicago, the situations with Trayvon Martin, and, you know, kids like that.
Is it set in Chicago?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
And I think it just it was great writing. Kenyon Burns did a great job with writing, and I was like, I say it's like
he's the writer of Blackish.
Yes.
Right? Okay. Cool.
And he was also a producer.
Okay.
I said it's like. The words were like butter on an actor's tongue. It just melted. It just melted, you know, so great job.
That's excellent. That means we're going to have to check it out. Yeah, we got a lot of movies to see today.
Don't bootleg them. Go see them.
We had that conversation. Somebody was trying to say they bootleg after it comes out, but I was like, never that. Right. Not, you know, if you get your SAG card, you be feeling some type of way.
And you know, it's funny, like, that it's like, when you know people that bootleg, and then you in the business, and they bootleg your stuff, you're like, hey, man, your movie was good, man. I sold out of it. Dude, you bootleg my stuff, bro?
Right, and then you telling me about it.
And you telling me about it?
Like, your feelings is a little hurt. Dang. You want to do something. You know that's a crime, right? I'm going to drop a dime on you.
So like, man, don't tell me that.
Wow. That's actually, you know what? I want to, before we wrap it up, we're going to get into it, but it was an excellent event when we talk about philanthropy. Mm-hmm. Sports Spectacular happened this past Friday, and I was invited out. What it was, they partner, usually they honor excellence in sports. This year they teamed up with the Clippers, and they honored the whole Clippers organization,
okay,
as well, who just clinched the playoffs. Okay. So, woo-woo.
At least they ain't got to face Houston this time.
Right. This is Kobe's last year. It's kind of like a bittersweet moment for me with basketball this year. It's like, oh, I just thought of something before we go into. But we're going to play it. Okay, I'm going to play this. And while we're playing it, since it's pictures only, I'm going to still talk. Okay, we're just going to play our Sports Spectacular pictures. Doc Rivers, Kevin Frazier hosted, Jim Hill hosted. As well as John Sally. Okay. They hosted the event. They honored Von Miller, the linebacker from Denver Broncos, who was the MVP of the, Super Bowl this year. You can go ahead and play it, cousin. Go ahead. We got you. I'm just going to keep talking. Yeah, I was saying that it's bittersweet for me with basketball this year and the NBA, just because, you know, Kobe being gone, I'm just going to miss him. You know what I mean? But, I mean, 20 years being on the same team, being this consistent, setting the records, it's going to take a minute. Even though Steph Curry and a lot of young players coming for him, but it's going to take a minute to match a lot of the records that he broke. So, I mean, kudos to Kobe and this being your final year and just all of that. What I did want to say, how do you feel about the guy code on this one? It was something that came out about the Lakers with, I don't know his name, is it Russell is his name? But anyway, he filmed something from Swaggy P, which is, our fellow Aussie, Iggy Azalea's fiance. That's, his name is Nick Young. It's not Swaggy P is his Instagram name. But his nickname. Okay. So, but the Russell, who is either one of the newer players on the Lakers, you heard about that?
Nah.
He's sitting there talking to him. They in a home setting or something. He videoing it. You could barely see it. And he's like, yo, what you think about this girl? Would you do this to this girl? Would you do this? And he's answering them candidly. Like, yeah, I would do this. Oh, she know my girl. What?
This is the type of stuff I have no comments for.
Hey, don't come over.
This is the type of stuff. He always has no comments. But is there a guy, like, how do you feel about that? Like, that the Lakers have ostracized him in the locker room and said he cannot speak with the other team, or they've done something where Russell? They're making him feel it. Like, how do you record something and release it to a social media?
I think that's that's a punk move. I don't understand.
Why would you do that?
Because exactly, you know, but also,
lame.
But also, as a guy, you gotta be smart and understand under no circumstances should you answer those type of questions, because you're putting yourself in that situation. No. But your comment should be like, "Nah, I'm good. My girl is enough for me." You know what I mean? That's right. Listen. Mm-hmm. Even as a guy,
this is a good husband right there.
I'm saying, because the thing is, if somebody asking you, would you smash this? If you're thinking about them, then you already, you know what I mean? Like, then that means that you ain't happy at home. Like, if somebody's like, hey, if Kim Kardashian or Halle Berry asked you to smash, would you? Like, no, I'm good with my wife. I'm married. You know what I mean? Like, you know what I did to get married? Like, listen, nah. Exactly, man. I'm like, I'm good. My home is good. I'm trying to stay married. So everybody's different though. Mm-hmm. But I think that wasn't cool on his part as your teammate.
Yeah.
And then you putting it out there.
He did not release it like subliminally. He released it to like a site. Like that they blasted it. And then I don't know how it got out that it came from him, but who else was in there?
Exactly. Who else asking the questions?
Right. And it's on your phone. But that was his.
I don't believe in violence, but he should have caught one for that one.
he catching it. He's catching it in other ways. They can't do that. He not going. Who was that did something in the locker room one day? Was it Blake Griffin? Didn't he sock somebody?
His the equipment manager or something like that? Yeah. I'm not going to talk about that foolishness.
I think that you're an athlete. You know, I think that that's an emotion. Like, sports can be emotional when you're winning or losing either way. Like,
when you're making millions of dollars, come on now. You don't punch nobody. Like, that's just.
Right?
Like, and you break your hand on top of that. You broke your hand, and now you can't play.
But right.
Then
and he got fined.
And then your team was doing better without you.
Right.
It doesn't make sense.
All right. Well, I can't believe that you made this hour go by really, really fast. I feel like I could keep talking.
Yeah.
That's the big homie? You the big homie?
Hey, you ain't know.
Is there anything we forgot or left out?
Nah, I mean, I just wanted the people to leave away with knowing that believe in yourself. Don't wait for someone to tell you that you're great or you can do this, do that. If you believe in yourself, then you halfway to the mark. And, you know, for me, my goal is to stay positive, keep God first, and make sure that I don't compromise what it is that I'm in this business to do. Mm-hmm. I'm not in the business for fame or fortune. I want to be debt-free. Let's just be honest. I want to be debt-free, not owe nobody. And if I got a lot of money, cool. But long as I can take care of my family and pay my bills, I'm happy. Like, I just want to have fun and do what God intended for me to do on this earth and make a difference.
And I think, you're going to make a difference. Shout out to you and all this film. Like, 50 Cent going to make your movie, right?
We'll see.
We're going to put that in the air. We putting it out there.
Listen, we'll see.
And I'm going to play
But you know the funny thing I think that it's funny when you do things you don't realize who's watching.
Right.
And people will contact me and be like, "Yo, I'm watching what you're doing. I'm seeing what you're doing. Keep doing what you're doing." And then out the woodwork, somebody will be like, "Hey, can you produce this project with me? Can you direct this project?" And I'm like, "For real?"
I got you. So that means stay diligent, stay focused. Yeah. Stay consistent.
Right.
Stay persistent.
Stay on course. Stay on course.
Don't lose focus. Yeah. Don't get caught up in all of the lights.
Yeah.
Like they say.
When the acting jobs ain't coming, you create your own.
Amen. Okay, well, we're going to close it out on that, but I do want to thank you.
Thank you.
For being here, sharing your time, yourself with us at Beauty and the Beat.
Yeah.
And also, I want to thank Body Products. I mean, you see, we didn't throw these were the samples, but we had to try them before we tell you about it. But for our callers and listeners that DM'd us, we're checking our Instagram, so we're gonna send this to you. We're gonna get you your mommy scrub, your daddy scrub, and we're gonna help you get some Frank body in your life and how to become a Frankfurt and how to follow them and catch up with them. And can you show some of their pictures of like how beautiful their Instagram, because they have the most awesome. I mean, if you haven't checked out frankbody.com or frankbod_bod, their Instagram, like, it was voted like one of the, like, in the top 20. Look at this. This is just awesomeness of just how visual. But I mean, that's what I'm saying about how, like she said, these models, 100,000 times, 100,000 times, 100,000 times, 100,000. If you got followers, that's why they're at 20 million in sales and almost a million or 700,000 followers so quickly.
Right.
You know what I mean? This was not, it's not a game. So both of you guys, businesses, like just strategizing and being about what you're about, it's just awesome. So we're going to stay in touch. We're going to recap this and show you online how to get some Frank body stuff. We're going to make sure you and your wife get some. She sounds like she's trying to make a baby.
Hey, listen, we trying to make a baby. Yes.
Yes. Already, both of y'all. Already, I didn't mean it takes two.
That's right. She's going to be a girl, already claiming it. Her name is Hope. So, yeah. There you go.
You're so awesome.
I have an awesome wife, so I'm just, you know.
Yes.
I'm a blessed man. Awesome. So, you know, God is good.
I appreciate you, Mr. Melvin Jackson
Thank
Jr.
You.
And I appreciate everything. And Beauty and the Beat, I appreciate everyone. Welcome, Miss Haley. We didn't even introduce you. Say hi, Haley.
Hi.
Miss Glam. Yeah, so everybody tune in, beautyandthebeat.la, and follow us on what? Beauty and the Beat Radio.
Yes.
And did I forget anything? We good. And we out. Thank you, cousin.